The tree of life, Malchut. Malchut means kingdom. So, Malchut Sheme Matiachur, the kingdom within Matthew. Because Matthew speaks, Yeshua speaks much about Malchut, and Matiachu carries most of the greater significance of it. That Malchut is used in two forms. One is Malchut Kashamayim, the kingdom of heaven, and the other is Malchut Elohim, the kingdom of God. What is the distinction between the two? Nothing at all. They both mean the same thing. The only difference is that even in the days of Yeshua, there was a growing respect for Hashem, for the name, and for these terms, and so more and more euphemisms were being used even in the days of Yeshua. It is amazing, something that we should concern ourselves with, that in the Brit Chadashah, in the New Testament, we do not find the term Yud-Kei-Vav-Kei. We do not find the name in all of the New Testament. It is not used. And so the scholars tell us that this is because even by the time of Yeshua, by the time of Herod's temple, that the name was coming into common, was going out of common use, going into common disuse, that it would only be used at specific times. For example, in the local customs, it would be used in the synagogue when there was a minyan. There had to be a minyan, 10 men present, 10 men of age who had been circumcised, who had been bar mitzvah, and only then could the name be used. So when they were reading the Torah scroll and such as that, the name would not be used. The name would be used in the Beit HaMikdash, but out in the common areas and things like that, it was refrained from being used. And so this is the distinction between Malchut Kashamayim, the kingdom of heaven, and Malchut Elohim, the kingdom of God. By definition, there's no distinction. They both mean the same thing, but the Shemayim was more euphemistic out of respect for Hashem. And so in saying that, we were talking about the things, certain aspects of Malchut that we find in Matiyahu that we talked about that it talks about in chapter 5. In chapter 5, it talks about the citizenship, the blessings, the promise of the true tzaddik. Chapter 8, Matiyahu chapter 8 and verse 11 tells us that goyim, that the Gentiles are in Malchut, that pagans are in Malchut. Why? How can we say that there are goyim and that there are pagans in Malchut? Because who's in Malchut? Everybody's in Malchut. It does not mean that everybody is a citizen of Malchut, but that everybody is in the kingdom, but not everybody is of the kingdom. Just like we are all in the United States, but that doesn't mean that everybody is a citizen of the United States. We have people who are here who are not citizens. We'll call them visitors. We have people who are here who are not citizens, all right? And so some of them are here legally, some of them are not here legally, but they're here. Okay, so whatever. So Malchut tells us the same thing about the Goyim, that there are Goyim in Malchut chapter 8, verse 11. The next thing is that that Malchut has two types of Malchut is actually composed of two types of people: those who are true citizens and those who are only profess to be citizens. And in chapter 13, and in chapter 22. And in chapter 25, we find that those who are professors, who are mere, that these are cast out, that these are excluded. And so we need to be very careful. We're going to get into that deeper, more deeply tonight. The latter are cast out at the end. You must be a true citizen. You cannot just be, you can't just claim to be a citizen. You must be a citizen. And so, in saying that, and of course, this is the parable of the mustard seed. Malchut is subject to rapid growth. Matthew 13, 31 and 32. That the Malchut is subject to rapid growth. In other words, when the kingdom takes off, it can take off very quickly. Now, what causes the kingdom to take off? What causes the rapid growth? So what causes the seed, the mustard seed, to take off as it does? Very good. Say it aloud.
Somebody's watering it.
And what else? It must have water and
sunlight
and nourishment, these things. It must be properly cared for. Okay? It must be properly cared for, and then it will take off. Saying what? What does this say to us? Say it out loud. I can't read your lips. Did you say no new taxes? So what? How does this happen?
We take care of people.
But who's the one who waters? And who's the one who gives sunlight? And who's the one who does these things? Remember what the parable is. Yeshua is talking about that if I have the emunah of a mustard seed, what?
It's totally
so my total, it's my, in saying that it's between God and myself. What causes my growth is not you. And what causes your growth is not me. What do we do for one another? Well, we give one another information and company and these kinds of things, cross-pollination, if you would. We do these kinds of things, but I do not cause your growth and you do not cause my growth. Just before the parable of the mustard seed was the parable of the sower. And who is the sower? Who is the one who brings forth the increase? What does Yeshua say? Who brings the increase? Hashem. God does. My responsibility is to receive what God is giving. Then I will grow. He gives me what I need. He gives me the sunlight. He gives me the rain, the water. He gives me the nourishment, the nutrients. He gives me what I need. What I need to do, my part then, is to take that and apply it so that I can grow, so that I can live and grow.
So in the same way that we are dependent on Hashem for our growth, when there's no growth, it's not necessarily.
If I'm not growing, yes, it's never Him. His whole aspect is for what? And in fact, in 1 Corinthians, Rav Shaul chastises the church or the assembly of Corinth. For what? For their lack of growth. For their lack of spirituality. He says, you are yet babes. He says, I would give you meat if you could handle the meat, but you can't handle the meat. I'm still giving you milk. And so, we must be careful to understand. Oftentimes, we want to blame. We want to cast blame. Well, it's the pastor's fault, it's the rabbi's fault, it's the leader's fault, or it's that person's fault, or someone else's fault. And we want to cast blame because I'm not growing. No, it's my fault that I'm not growing. It's up to me. I'm the one who's responsible. As I said on Shabbat, my worst enemy is, my biggest problem is me, not you. It's not you, it's me. My problem is with me. And so we're subject to rapid growth. When do we see rapid growth? When the people of Hashem are doing what they're supposed to be doing with the attitude, with the heart that they're supposed to be doing it, then we become attractive to others. So let me ask you, this assembly, or churches, or other groups, or what have you, how attractive are we to others? You see, the statistics tell us today that people are walking away from organized religion in tremendous numbers. Tremendous numbers. And churches are falling apart. And assemblies are barely making it. Groups like this. Groups like this. Struggle. Not all of them, there are some exceptions, but for the most part, there's a great struggle taking place. Why? Why do you suppose that is? There was the church that Wilma and I attended, where we met actually, in Chattanooga, Tennessee. It was the, I don't know if we use of a better word, it was the owner of the Bible college that we were attending. And so the students were required to attend the services there, were required to attend the church there. And after the pastor who founded the Bible college, he retired. He was in his 80s and he retired. And they brought in a new pastor and people didn't like him and this and that and whatever. The college started going down. So if the college is going down, what does that tell you? Because there were, when Miss Wilma and I were there, there were like between 4,000 and 5,000 students at this college. It was a fairly large college for a private Bible college. And they all went to this church. So guess what? This church had a huge auditorium. And it was packed full Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. I mean, you could not get a seat in this place. And then they had a bus ministry and they had all these things. And so there were literally thousands of people coming to this church. That's how I met my wife, because I was in the bus ministry and we had an afternoon Sunday school where we would bring children from the communities into the church for Sunday school in the afternoon. And then we would take the kids home on the buses. And so I came in the training union. It was a Baptist church. They had a Baptist training union. Training union had already started, and I came in. They were showing a movie. All the lights were off, and I'm walking into the auditorium, thousands of people in this huge church. And we had met each other, and she saw me passing, and there was nowhere for me to sit. And I was looking around. I stopped, and I was looking around, and she said, "Psst." And so I wondered who had the leak. "Psst." And I turned around and she was there and she said, "You want to sit with us?" And there were like her and several of her girlfriends sitting there. And so, what could I say? My hair, right? Just kidding. So I sat down and that was the beginning of a long relationship. Right? So I told people, she's 2 years older than me. She robbed the cradle. I was not even a freshman in college yet when she picked me up. Anyway, so this church finally collapsed on itself. Had to sell the college, had to sell all the property. They moved to another location, and they were running. They had dropped from 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 people to 100. And I was looking on their website the other day. I was feeling, what do you call it?
Nostalgic.
Yes. Nostalgic. And so I was looking at their webpage the other day. They changed the name of the church and everything. And their motto is the funnest church in town. Really? The funnest church in town. And I thought, well, that explains a lot. They're the only church in the area with a zip line. And they have horseback riding, and they have this, and they have that, and they have all of these things. Fine. But that's not our purpose. They can do that at the carnival. this is the problem. We're trying to take, we're trying to bring people in by giving them, by bringing the world inside. And making it fun. Understand what I'm saying here. Do not misunderstand. When I say we are not here to have fun, we are here to serve. That does not mean it cannot be enjoyable. Because honestly, I enjoy Shabbat. And I enjoy the classes. I enjoy these things. Perhaps everyone doesn't agree with me. That's okay. But I'm just saying. That doesn't, there's a difference between having fun, i.e. we're playing games and we're doing these things and it's all about excitement. But what does that have to do? Because when we're doing these kinds of things, what are we building on? Nefesh pechama or nefesh shemayim? It's about excitement, about physical excitement and entertainment, and that's not what we're about. We're here to put down the nefesh bechama and to raise the spirit of him. This is why. This is why. Because people can't tell the difference. And if they can't tell the difference, why should they be there? They can have more fun watching a movie, staying at home, sleeping in, going water skiing, going fishing, what have you. We were members of a church where one of the pastor bragged about one of his friend pastors who lives near the beach, not here, lives near the beach. And he kept his surfboard leaning up against the outside of the church. Because the church was near the beach, so as soon as the Sunday morning service was over, he would go put on his wetsuit and go get his board and go out and go surfing. Good. I'm just saying, what's our purpose here? What are we doing? So, when we're talking about rapid growth, there's a reason why. There's a reason why. That it happens and it does not happen. And both of those reasons are me. How good am I doing at following Hashem? Following His instructions. Loving Him with all of my heart. If we truly loved Hashem with all of our heart, how do you think we would be? What kind of people would we be? If we were truly loving our neighbors as ourselves, what kind of people, what kind of distinction, what kind of difference would that be from everybody else? And this was the difference in the book of Acts. This is exactly what happened. They were expressing their love to Hashem in such a wonderful and beautiful way, and expressing their love to one another, and expressing their love to their neighbors and to their, you know, to the people around them in such a wonderful, beautiful way, that it attracted the others in substantial numbers. So, if you want people to join you, don't walk around telling them about how you are Torah observant, how you keep Shabbat, how you keep kosher, how you do all of these things, because that's going to have no effect on them. If you want people to join you in this walk, they will join you. If you will love them and have compassion on them and demonstrate your talk not with your mouth but with your actions. Because what he says, do not love by word. But by what? By your deed. Don't tell people that you love them. Prove it. Show it. Demonstrate it. Go out of your way. Go out of your way. Then when they see the tzitzit, then when they see the kippah, then when they see your head covered, then when they see the way you're dressing and how you're acting and how you're living, then it becomes something to them. But if we're living just like everybody else, and we're not showing any more compassion than anybody else, and we're not loving Hashem any more than anybody else because I'm wearing a kippah, guess what? It makes the kippah a disgrace. It disgraces the kippah. It disgraces the tzitzit. It disgraces all of these things. So if you would, let's go to 13. Matthew 13. And 33 through 33. So Matthew 13:33, he told them another parable. Malchut Hashemayim, the kingdom of heaven, is like chametz, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened. So, Malchut Hashemayim, the kingdom of heaven, is like chametz. Say what? The kingdom has leavening in it. Now we just came out of Pesach, in which we were to do what? We were to put away the leaven. All of our leavening. Correct? And you have heard it taught, as have I, that leavening represents sin. But not so. Not necessarily. Why? How can we say this? Okay, so let's talk about leavening. Let's talk about Pesach. Is it forbidden for us to have leavening absolutely at all?
No.
I may eat leavening. Correct?
Yes.
Only what?
Just not during
Pesach.
51 weeks.
Just not during the days of unleavened bread. Okay? Yomim lo chametz. The days without leaven. So what is the lesson here? Because if I can have leavening at any other time, but just not on Pesach, then how is this representing sin? Because should I then just put away the chametz only at Passover? Or if it's representing sin, should I put away chametz? You see, the oinker, the bacon that walks on 4 legs, the pig, the hog, the oinker, bacon walking around on 4 legs, that's just like, you know what a cow is, right? It's a hamburger on 4 legs. I know that's deep, right? So, when is it forbidden for me to eat pork?
24/7,
365. Meaning what?
Every day.
Every moment, every day, all the time. It is forbidden. Why? Because it is unclean, period. It cannot be cleansed. Therefore, there is no time, there is no day in which it is. So which would be more demonstrative of sin? Chametz or swine? So why is it then that chametz is forbidden during Pesach, but is permitted at other times? And that's one of the 4 questions, is it not? Remember? Nathan read the four questions for us during the Pesach Seder, right? And one of the four questions is what? Why every night, every other night, we eat chametz, but on this night we do not eat chametz, but we eat matzah? So what is the answer? If chametz is not representing of sin, what is it representing? All things are permissible, but all things are not profitable. Saying what? Is it wrong to have a television in my house? No. Is it wrong for me to watch certain shows on the television? Yes. And saying what? So if this person is offended that I have a television in my house, then what? What should I do? This is what the scripture says. Your argument is not with me. What?
Not invite the person over.
Don't invite that person over. No. That's not the spirit.
Throw it out.
At least let it not be seen. If it is an offense, then don't let it be seen. Saying what? Okay. Some of you eat cheeseburgers. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands. Some of you eat cheeseburgers. Okay? What if you are around, you're proclaiming your association to Judaism, and particularly we associate with what branch? What?
Orthodox.
So, I'm proclaiming my association to Judaism, and an Orthodox Jewish person sees me eating a cheeseburger, then what? Are they offended or not offended?
Yes.
You know they're going to be. And they're going to say, you see. Therefore, what?
Anything you have to say is...
Hmm?
Anything that you have to say or teach or share is not critique.
Correct. Because they're going to think that you are... Yes. They're going to think that you are a hypocrite. They're going to think that you are trying to play both sides. Now, this is the way it is. I won't get into an argument, a debate with you over whether you should or you shouldn't. I'm just saying, guess what? There are Messianics who live an Orthodox lifestyle, a very, what would we call it, kashrut. And they follow this doctrine, and they do not mix meat and milk. And you're sitting there with them, and so what happens? Are you offensive to them? The truth is yes. Now, while we're saying, well, they should be offended, they should be more mature. This is exactly what Rav Shaul is talking about. No, you should be the mature one. Quit waiting for someone else to be the mature one. You grow up, you be mature, and you learn to set aside. This is what a mother does for the child. No. How many of you mothers here sacrifice for your children? No. How much do you sacrifice? You do anything for them. Anything for their well-being. Who's the mature one? The mother or the child? How about fathers? I can tell you that in my life, I worked hard. I have ministered all of my adult life, as well as having worked another job, a secular job, all of my life. And for many of those years, even as it is now, for many of those years, it was in the construction business. Cold in the winter, hot in the summer. And you tell me, where is the spring and where's the fall? The 2 days of spring and the 2 days of fall, right? And why did I do that? To keep food on the table, to keep my boys in clothes, to let them do things to so that they could go places and have a good time with their friends and be able to have some spending money and all of these different kinds of things. Not everything they want and needed, but everything they or not everything they wanted, but everything they needed. Who's the mature one here? This is the leaven. That leavens the whole lump. It's my attitude. My unwillingness to sacrifice. Can I do this? Yes, but if you do this, what are the consequences? What are the consequences? What is the effect not on myself, but on others? Is it permissible for me to do this? Yes. But if I do this, are people still going to listen to me? This is what is being spoken to here. So, is it permissible for me to drink? Yes. To drink alcohol? Yes. But you know what? And I do partake of alcohol from time to time, but I will tell you what, there are people before whom I will not partake. I will not participate because I know it would be offending to them. Rather than offend them, I just don't do. It's easier for me to sacrifice a little bit of alcohol than for my brother and my sister to be offended because I do. If it offends you that I eat ice cream in front of you, then guess what? Guess what? I'm not going to eat ice cream in front of you. It's okay, I can't eat ice cream anyway. I'm just saying. If it offends you that I'm eating chips in front of you, I won't eat chips in front of you. If it offends you that I'm eating celery sticks, I won't eat celery sticks. If this is offensive to you, then I can put that off for now and behave in a way that's not offensive to you and eat my celery sticks later. So we have a synagogue here where it's the only synagogue in town. And there are people from all perspectives of Judaism that go there. There are, believe it or not, there are Messianics there. There are Orthodox Jews who go there. They are mostly Reformed. They're mostly Reformed. But there are Orthodox Jews who go there. There are conservative Jews who go there. And there are some Messianics who go there. Messianic meaning that they believe in Yeshua's Messiah. Now, they have the service, the liturgy, and then they have the the meal afterwards. Onik, Shabbat, and when they're having the Onik, the rabbi tells the people who are bringing food, I have heard this. The rabbi tells them, be careful what you bring. Why? Because there are people here who are Orthodox, who attend here, and if you're bringing milk and dairy things, meat and dairy things mixed, or what have you, so make sure, he says, be simple, just make sure everything is pie, make sure everything is, so that you're not offending your brother here. And what I'm saying is that we should be the same way. There is leavening in the kingdom. You see, what the leavening is, the leavening in and of itself is not bad. It is only how it's used. Do you see what I'm saying? Therefore, it's not, the leavening does not represent sin. The leavening represents something that is permissible but is not profitable for me at this time. At another time it may be profitable, but here and now it is not profitable. So, guess what? Here, we have Kiddush at the end of the service, right? We have kiddush. Should you have your choice between juice and wine? Many people here have juice, many people have wine. It's up to you. But we do have wine. Guess what I'm never going to do? I will never walk into the Baptist church and demand that they have kiddush with Mol and David. With wine. Guess what I'm not going to do? I will not walk into the Baptist church and demand that if they are serving communion, because you know the Baptist church, they serve what? Most Baptist churches serve what during communion?
Grape juice.
Grape juice. I go in there and I demand that they serve wine because Jesus drank wine. Jesus gave the men wine, a cup of wine at the end. So I demand, no, you have to do it exactly this way. Why? Is it permissible for me to drink wine? Yes. Is it always profitable? No. This is the leavening. Leavening is when I do something that is permissible but is not profitable. There is leavening in the kingdom. Leavening can also represent, and you notice that what does she do? She has leavening. Look at this. She has leavening. She has chametz. And what does she do? She hides it. Of all places, where? Why in the flour? Why would you hide the? Why would you hide the yeast in the flour? You know what's going to happen? Saying what? She's covering up her nefesh bechama with her nefesh shemayim. Saying she's covering up her physical failure with her religiosity, with her religion. She's covering up, she's trying to cover up the flesh by acting spiritual. You see that? And what happens? Does it work? No. Why does it not work? We're done. Why does it not work? Because there's leaven. And what does leaven do? Huh? It spreads. It corrupts. It corrupts. It ferments. Now the thing about fermentation is that if it's not stopped in time, it goes bad. It rots. Saying what? We do not believe in asceticism. This is why I said on Shabbat, we're not monks living in monasteries, isolated from everybody. We're not Gnostics who believe that every vile thing belongs to the earth and only the only good thing in life is that is spiritual. Because the scripture tells us, Shlomo tells us that all things came from Hashem. Everything has its purpose and its use. When it becomes bad for us is when we misuse it or abuse it. Is there anything wrong with alcohol? No, alcohol actually has many benefits. When is it bad? When is it wrong? When we abuse it. We're often told by those who are abstentionists, and that's fine, that's their prerogative, but we're told that, you know, because Rav Shaul, because the Apostle Paul says, be not drunk with wine. And I frequently point out, he says, be not drunk with wine. He did not say, do not drink. He said, do not drink to drunkenness. Why? Because in drunkenness is excess. Why? Because you stop feeling. And because you stop feeling, you lose that conscience, so to speak, to do and not to do. You lose your emotional, your conscientious guidance. But because a person takes a glass of wine, a glass of wine is not going to do that to you. It'll take a few glasses of wine to do that to you. He does not say do not drink wine. He says do not drink to drunkenness. So, the thing is this. Everything has the ability, every created thing has the ability to be used for good or for evil. In a spiritual way or in a physical way, in a fleshly way. Whether I eat or whether I drink or whatsoever I do, I am called to do it in a way, in a manner in which God will be glorified. This is what it is to be a citizen of the kingdom. That it is not for my sake, it is not for my purpose or my glory, but that everything that I do, everything that I say, all that I am is for His purpose and His glory. I am the servant, I am the slave, He is the king. Therefore, I am not here for my own benefit, I am here for His benefit. Therefore, if I am doing, because what happens? Let's pay attention so we can close. What happens? Because I say, I can do what I want, when I want, how I want, nobody has the right to tell me what to do. What?
Wrong.
Wrong. Why? Why?
Because we're not ourselves.
Because I do not belong to myself. Do you not know that you are not your own? You have been bought with a price. Kids. We have cameras going here. So just a little bit down. So I do not belong to myself. I belong to Hashem. And I belong to you, my neighbor. Won't you be my neighbor? I belong to you. I belong to you, my neighbor.
In that case.
So what? Now let me ask you the question. If a person is offended because I have a television set in my living room, and they're coming to my house, if they would be offended seeing the television set in my living room and they're coming to my house, most people would say, that's their problem. If you don't want to see my TV, don't come to my house. Guess what? That's the leaven. Is it wrong for you to have a TV in your house? No. Is it wrong for you to offend that person? Yes. Therefore, what? Put the TV away, if at all possible. I don't know, those 57-inch screens and you crank it down or whatever. Spin it around, put something over it, put flowers around it. Tell them it's a giant vase, whatever. But I have to go out of my way to do whatever I possibly can not to be offensive. That's the message. Do you see, once again, how this changes the attitude? How this is this distinguishing characteristic of a true citizen of the kingdom who is a servant of the king, refusing to be offensive if in any way reasonably possible, how people would look at us differently.
I don't want to be difficult.
You are different.
Exactly. Okay. But nowadays, people are offended at everything. If you have to cater to everybody, you get offended. It's exhausting. Mm-hmm. Actually, I find that's why I prefer to be by myself.
Yeah.
But the more I'm by myself, the less people I offend.
So, okay, everybody hear her point, which is correct. It's a good point. The counter to that is this. We were not told it was going to be easy. And we're not told to... I'm not talking about... I understand. Everybody's getting offended at everything today. Okay? I have a person who has a certain lifestyle, who gets offended at the things that I say. Someone who lives across the country from us, but we communicate on Facebook, and they frequently get offended, and they frequently post things that would be offensive to me. I have not changed this person's mind, and this person is not going to change my mind. So what do I do? He puts comments up there that are offensive, that are incorrect, and these kinds of things. What do I do? I don't respond.
I was going to say, unfollow, unfriend.
I cannot do that because of the circumstance and the situation. I just don't respond. It's as easy as that. I do not put myself in a position where I'm going to be offended. Now, there are going to be people who are offended at you because you keep Shabbat. I'm not telling you to run around and hide yourself. You know, people are offended because a person carries their Bible, so we hide our Bibles because they're offended. No, I'm not telling you that. That's the difference between chametz and matzah. What is matzah? Matzah are the things that you're commanded to do whether people are offended or not. Those things you do. It doesn't matter whether a person is offended. That's why I said as is possible. And even I even said as is reasonable. But this is the chametz. The chametz is when it's possible for me and I'm not breaking anything of God's instructions to me or these kinds of things, but I have my rights and I'm going to do what I'm going to do and I'm going to be what I'm going to be and these kinds of things, and we refuse to bend to our brother, because remember what the scripture says, which we will get into when we get into Netzach. From Yesod to Netzach, we are learning what, and from Netzach to Chor. The Netzach is about learning what? That you prefer one another above yourself. You see, this is the difficulty, because much of what we're fighting, I am having to fight that person's flesh, but at the same time, what? And my own. I get the double whammy, because they can insult me and say whatever and do whatever and walk away and they're fine. Guess what? I don't have that prerogative. Why do I not have that prerogative? I must speak to you appropriately at all times. I must deal with you appropriately at all times. Why? I do not have the prerogative of letting the flesh go however, wherever, do whatever. I must maintain the control. Why? As we started off, who's the adult here? Silent. Who's the mature one? And who's the child? So, as the mother told the father, you need to take care of this. And the father says, I don't want to. And she says, somebody's got to be the adult here. Right? Somebody's got to be the adult in the room. And guess what? We're it. All of us. This is the aim, this is the goal, to mature. We're called to be the adults. So on Facebook, when you've got this argument breaking out or whatever, what do? You can get involved in it, or you can walk away. The truth of the matter is, the choice is yours. Now, I can get my pride all hurt or whatever, and I'm going to prove that I'm right. You're not proving that you're right. You're proving that you have an ego. Or you can just get out of it, walk away. As my mom used to tell us, because we grew up in a big family, there were 10 kids, we got into arguments. We got into downright knockdown, drag out brawls. 8 boys, you better believe there was some fighting going on. We got into arguments where the family would literally divide, the kids would literally divide. Half would be on this side and half would be on that side of the argument. Be arguing back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And it would frustrate my mom that we would be arguing. And she would tell us, walk away. One of her most famous quotes, it takes two to make an argument. What does that mean, it takes two to make an argument? If I'm arguing with you, but you're walking away, who am I arguing with? That's what she was saying. You see, if you just walk away, they're standing there talking to themselves. There's no fun in that. Who wants to stand there and talk to themselves? You can argue with the wall. Right? Any fun arguing with the wall? Let me say this. The thing about arguing is the flesh likes it. The flesh likes it. God doesn't. God doesn't care for it. That's why we are told to avoid it. This is chametz. Chametz is not the things you are commanded to do. And someone gets offended because you're doing something. Chametz is things that you have the right to do, but they're not necessary. And if somebody's offended with it, let it go. You can do it later, you can whatever later. You see what I'm saying? This is what it's talking about. And so we must guard against that. So next week we're going to take up. It's not easy. That's a good following for this one. It's not easy being a citizen of the kingdom. And so with that we say, Rachot Shalom Elayla Tov.